Welcome back to our lecture series on nanostructural materials, science and technology. I am Professor Ashutosh Tiwari from the Department of Material Science and Engineering at the University of Utah. In the last lecture, we explored how scaling laws influence optics and heat transfer, seeing how light behaves differently at small scales, and how thermal transport becomes increasingly important for nanoelectronics and photonic devices. Today, in lecture 5, we shift our focus to scaling in fluids. We will examine how fluid flow changes when dimensions shrink, starting from pipe flow and pressure drop to real-world examples like blood flow in arteries. We will also see why traditional pumping fails at micro and nano scales, leading to new technologies like electroosmotics and electrophoretic pumping. Finally, we will connect these ideas to falling bodies in fluids and even raindrops to see how scaling laws shape the physical world around us. And as we shall discover, these same principles extend into biological systems, helping us understand blood flow, metabolism, heart rate, and even lifespan across species. Let us begin our discussion of scaling in fluids. All bodies, whether living or non-living, move in fluid environments. For example, birds flying in air, fish swimming in water, or even the flow of blood cells inside our body. These interactions with fluid are everywhere in nature and in technology. Scaling in fluid mechanics helps us understand how fluid behavior changes as the size of the system changes, which we represent by the characteristic dimension d. This idea is especially important in nanotechnology, where we deal with extremely small devices. In microfluidics, which involves manipulating tiny volumes of fluid in lab-on-chip systems, and in biological systems, such as blood flow in our capillaries. We will start our discussion with laminar flow. Laminar flow means that the fluid moves in smooth parallel layers with very little mixing. This is different from turbulent flow, where the fluid swirls and mixes randomly. We see laminar flow in many everyday situations. Water moving through thin capillaries or straws, blood flowing smoothly in our vessels, and oil moving steadily through pipelines at low speed. For laminar flow in a pipe, the volumetric flow rate is given by Poiseuille's law, which is Q volume equals pi times d to the power of 4 times the pressure difference divided by 8 times viscosity times length. From this, we see that the flow rate is proportional to the d to the power of 4. This means the flow rate is extremely sensitive to the pipe diameter. Even a small reduction in diameter leads to a large reduction in flow. Now let us look at how pressure drop scales. From Poiseuille's law, the volumetric flow rate depends on the pipe diameter raised to the 4th power. If we rearrange this equation, we can express the pressure gradient, that is pressure drop per unit length, as being proportional to the flow rate divided by the diameter to the 4th power. If we want to keep the flow rate constant, this means the pressure gradient scales as 1 over the square of the diameter. The implication is very important. As the diameter gets smaller, the pressure needed to maintain the same flow increases steeply. For example, if you reduce the diameter by a factor of 10, the required pressure increases by about 100 times. This scaling is why pressure-driven pumping becomes impractical in nanofluidic systems. Instead, engineers turn to alternative pumping methods such as electroosmotic or electrophoretic flow to move fluids effectively at these scales. Blood is a viscous fluid moving through arteries and veins. While real blood flow is pulsatile due to the heartbeat and the vessels are elastic, for scaling purposes, it can often be approximated by Poiseuille's law. According to this law, the blood flow rate is proportional to the 4th power of the artery's radius. This scaling has dramatic consequences. Even a small narrowing of an artery leads to a huge reduction in blood supply. For example, if the radius is reduced by half, the flow decreases to 1/16th of its original value. That is only about 6%. This explains why cardiovascular system is extremely sensitive to narrowing of the arteries called stenosis. Even moderate plaque buildup can reduce blood flow significantly. The heart must then compensate by generating higher pressure, which contributes to hypertension. Clinically, narrowing of coronary arteries reduces oxygen supply to the heart muscles, causing angina or heart attack. Narrowing in brain arteries can lead to stroke. Medical interventions such as stents, bypass surgery, or angioplasty work by restoring the vessel diameter. And because of the radius to the fourth power scaling, even small increases in diameter can dramatically improve blood flow. In microfluidics and nanofluidics, pressure-driven flow becomes impractical because the pressure needed rises dramatically as channels get smaller. Instead, engineers use electrohydrodynamic pumping, which relies on surface-driven forces rather than bulk pressure. The most common technique include electroosmosis, where an electric field moves ions near a charged surface and drag fluid along. Electrophoresis, where charged particles like DNA or proteins are moved by an electric field. And electrophoresis, where neutral but polarizable particles are manipulated by non-uniform electric fields. These approaches make it possible to pump and control fluid at very small scales, where traditional pumps cannot pump. Electroosmotic flow occurs when the walls of a channel develop surface charges that attract counter ions from the fluid. When an electric field is applied, these ions move, and in doing so, they drag the fluid with them. Unlike pressure-driven flow, this creates a nearly plug-like velocity profile, and the flow rate depends on the applied voltage rather than the fourth power of the channel diameter. Electroosmotic flow is widely used in biotechnology and pharmaceuticals. In capillary electrophoresis, it helps separate and analyze DNA and proteins. In lab-on-a-chip devices, EUF pumps small fluid volumes for rapid diagnostic tests. It is also applied in drug delivery, where fluids can be moved across nanopores and membranes in a highly controlled way. Electrophoresis is the motion of charged particles in response to an electric field. The velocity depends on the particle's charge, its size, and its viscosity of the medium. It is one of the most widely used techniques in biotechnology and pharmaceutical science. For example, gel electrophoresis is a standard method for separating DNA, RNA, and proteins. Capillary electrophoresis is used extensively in pharmaceuticals, quality control to analyze drug purity and detect metabolites. Electrophoresis is also applied in protein purification, which is essential for producing therapeutic proteins such as antibodies or insulin. Beyond that, it is even used to manipulate nanoparticles, a key step in developing advanced drug delivery systems. So far, we have looked at how fluids move inside channels, where the characteristic dimension was the pipe diameter or artery radius. Now, let us turn to how fluids affect the motion of objects falling through them. When a sphere falls in a fluid, two competing forces act on it, gravity pulling it downward and viscous drag resisting the motion. At first, the sphere accelerates, but very soon gravity and drag balance. At that point, the sphere falls at a constant speed called the terminal velocity. The expression for terminal velocity is given by 2 times g times r squared times the density difference between the sphere and the fluid, divided by 9 times the viscosity. For scaling purposes, the characteristic length here is the sphere's radius r. This means that terminal velocity scales as r squared or equivalently as the diameter squared. This scaling gives us important physical insight. Larger spheres fall much faster, while very small particles remain suspended for long periods of time. That is why raindrops fall quickly to the ground, but tiny droplets can stay afloat in clouds for long. It is also why fine dust and pollution particles linger in the air for hours, while larger particles settle out rapidly. Let us see how scaling affects raindrops. We start with a tiny droplet about 20 micrometers in diameter, which means the radius is 10 micrometers. The terminal velocity is given by Stokes' law, 2 g r squared times the density difference between the water and air divided by 9 times viscosity. For the parameters, we have gravity G as 9.8 meters per second squared. Density of water is about 1000 kilograms per cubic meter, while the density of air is only about 1.2. That means the effective density difference is essentially 1000 kilograms per cubic meter. The viscosity of air is about 1.8 times 10 to the minus 5 Newton seconds per square meter. Putting these values together gives a terminal velocity of roughly 0.01 meter per second, just 1 centimeter per second. That is so slow that these droplets can easily stay afloat in clouds supported by even gentle air currents. Now imagine 1,000 such droplets merging. The total volume increases by a factor of 1,000. So the radius increases tenfold. Because terminal velocity scales as the square of the radius, the new drop falls 100 times faster, about 1 meter per second. This simple scaling law explains the difference between cloud droplet and raindrops. Tiny droplets float and form clouds, while larger merged drops fall rapidly to the ground as rain. Now let us compare two important scaling laws. First, from Poiseuille's law for pipe flow, the volumetric flow rate increases as the diameter to the fourth power, while the pressure drop per unit length scales as 1 over the square of the diameter. That means even small changes in diameter can have a huge effect on flow and pressure. Next, from Stokes' law for falling bodies, the terminal velocity scales as the square of the diameter, and the time it takes to reach that velocity also scales as the square of the diameter. The big picture is this. Scaling laws dominate the design of micro and nanofluidic systems, and they also explain many flows that occur in biological systems. Up to this point, we have focused on fluids and physical systems, but scaling is equally important in biology. Living organisms show clear patterns where size dictates lifespan, heartbeat, and metabolism. What is remarkable is that these follow consistent rules known as quarter power scaling laws. These laws link tiny creatures like mice to much larger species like elephants and even whales. In this section, we will see how size shapes the rhythm of life itself. Lifespan is one of the clearest examples of biological scaling. It increases with body mass to the 1/4 power. That means larger animals live longer, but not in direct proportion to their mass. For example, a cat is about 100 times heavier than a mouse, yet its lifespan is only about 3 times greater. This is why we see a pattern across nature. Bigger species tend to live longer lives, but the increase is gradual rather than dramatic. Now let us look at heart rate. Unlike lifespan, heart rate decreases as animals get bigger. The scaling law shows it varies as the negative 1/4 power of mass. That is why a mouse's heart races at several hundred beats per minute, while a cat is slower, and an elephant is even slower. In other words, small animals live at a fast pace, while large animals live more slowly. The slowing of the heartbeat as the size increases is one of the most consistent biological trends we see. Metabolic rate is another quantity shaped by scaling. It increases with body mass, but only to the 3/4 power. This means larger animals use more total energy, but they are also more energy efficient than the smaller ones. A cat, for example, is about 100 times heavier than a mouse, but its metabolism is only about 30 times higher, not 100. That is why smaller animals eat constantly to fuel their fast metabolism, while larger animals can survive on proportionally less food per unit of body mass. To understand why metabolism scales this way, it helps to think about geometry. The surface to volume ratio decreases as the animals get bigger. A mouse has a lot of surface area compared to its tiny body, so it loses heat quickly and must burn energy at a very high rate to stay warm. An elephant, on the other hand, has much less surface area relative to its mass. So it retains heat and needs a slower metabolism to prevent overheating. This simple geometric principle is at the heart of many biological patterns. When we put these laws together, we see a remarkable unifying picture. Lifespan increases with mass to the 1/4 power. Heart rate decreases with mass to the negative 1/4. Metabolic rate increases with mass to the 3/4 power. These separate relationships combine to reveal one of biology's most fascinating constants. Across species, animals average about 1 billion heartbeats in a lifetime. Whether it is a mouse racing through a life, a cat, a human, or even an elephant, the total number of heartbeats remains roughly the same. Scaling gives us a lens to see the hidden order connecting all forms of life. This concludes our discussion on scaling laws. We have seen how scaling principles explain fluids, biology, and even falling bodies. But it is equally important to remember their limitations. Scaling laws are best thought of as guides, useful for estimation and intuition, but not exact. At very small nanometer scales, scaling predictions can fail. Mechanical scaling is usually reliable, but electromagnetic and thermal scaling often break down. This happens because scaling assumes matter behaves as a continuum, which is no longer true at nanoscale, where atomic, thermal, and quantum effects dominate. The key takeaway is that scaling laws are powerful tools, but they must be applied with discretion, especially when moving from macroscopic to the nanoscale world. Scaling laws gave us remarkable insight into fluids, biology, and motion, but they are not the full story. At very small scales, matter no longer behaves as a smooth continuum. Electrons, atoms, and energy itself follow quantum rules that classical physics cannot explain. In our next lecture, we will shift from classical scaling to the world of quantum mechanics, exploring wave-particle duality, quantization, and the strange but powerful principles that govern the nanoscale.